Hey everybody, Rob from Karma Comment Chameleon coming at you today with a new Pro Revenge story. Woman tears down our fence for satellite TV, and 10 years later, the police chief is fired as a direct result. Let's jump right in. July of 2002, when I was 16, our neighbor, who was a brat with a capital C, decided she wanted to have satellite TV installed. The house she lived in had a very small yard in back, smaller in front, and the fence that my mother had installed a couple of years ago was only about 5 yards from her side door. The only place the satellite could be installed was on the back of the house, but there was no way the vehicles could make it to her backyard. So, in her infinite wisdom, Brat decided to have them tear down our fence and drive over our property to get to her backyard. This starts a huge fight between her and my mother. Brat tries to claim that Mom built the fence too close to her house anyway, and Mom produced the land description to prove the fence was in the right spot. Turns out, they were both wrong. We knew the woman had built her house too close to the property line, but it seems it was closer than we thought. She was only feet from the line. That fence should have been almost touching the side of her house. Her uncle was the deputy mayor of our small 2,000 population town, and she tried to get him involved. Nothing came of it, so we thought it was over. Late September, early October that same year, while I was in school, Mom was taking a shower when our two dogs alerted her to someone at our door. She put on a bathrobe and went to see the police chief and about a dozen officers on our lawn, claiming they had been tipped off to a meth lab on the property and demanded to be allowed to search. Mom realized that Brat had to have been the one to call them, as the chief of police was known to be a personal friend to her family. Mom demanded a search warrant and they didn't have one, which triggered several hours of them refusing to leave until they searched the property. This all started around 9 or 10 in the morning. Nearing 3 p.m., Mom tells them she needs to pick me up from school and take me to her mother's house because I couldn't drive yet. They refuse to move their vehicles to let her leave and say it's fine, they'll send a squad car to pick me up, which would have just humiliated me. Mom calls her lawyer, who informs her that if they don't produce a warrant, tell them to leave. So, the chief tells her if he goes for a warrant, he'll tell whoever issues them that he can smell meth on the property and will be given a warrant for anything he asks for. He will then return and kick our door out of the frame. Mom called Grandma to pick me up from school nearly an hour after it let out and let the police search the house. They find my mom's gun safe. This safe was one of those made of steel with a circular lock, kind of like on a soda machine, and had the key sitting on top of it. Before anyone says how unsafe it is, it was just my mom and stepdad in the house most of the time. I was an only child and lived with my grandparents and only visited on weekends, and Mom kept the door to her room locked with a key. There was no way anyone under 18 was getting near her guns. The cops proceed to take a crowbar and pry the safe open, even though the key is right there, and it's clearly the key to the safe. They then take the guns outside and divide them up. They even take my mom's handgun, which she had a concealed carry permit for. This continued for hours until Mom relented and opened my stepdad's shop building. He was using it to house his motorcycle while he slowly restored it from a wreck about 15 years before. They barely got over the threshold of the door before screaming, "Meth lab!" and pointed to the cleaning agents and bottles that were all scooted together. Nothing else. No other signs of meth other than some cleaning agents and empty mason jars sitting near one another. They brought out heavy spot lamps and more cops. By 1 in the morning, my mother had been sitting outside in the cool, fall weather in nothing but a bathrobe this entire time. They claimed to have found a marijuana plant behind our 6-foot-tall privacy fence that kept people from seeing us in our hot tub. When I found out about this, I was upset. I was 16 and went to school in a small town. Everyone would know about it. The next day, Saturday, I was piddling around on the internet when a friend messaged me to ask what had happened. And why was my mother in jail? My mother was not in jail. My mom said it's on the news right now. Mom and stepdad are sitting in jail this weekend without bond for running the largest drug den in your town's history. When mom called the news to ask them why they'd ran that story without checking, they apologized and said they'd been contacted by town police and were told to run the story. The next night, they issued a public apology for it. I refused to go to school that Monday. It's very important to note that I had not been in school since Friday. On Tuesday, when my grandpa dropped me off, the drug-sniffing dog was at the school. However, as it was close to drug-free week, I thought nothing of it. My business teacher told me she'd seen the article in the local paper, but that it looked like it had been staged, and if I caught any crap for it, to let her know. I went to my locker as the officer walked out of the same hallway, but since that was the hall the principal's office was on, didn't think anything of it. I noticed a locker standing completely open, and when I got to it, I realized it was my locker. I blew up on the principal. I understand now that it's not my property, and the school can authorize it being searched, but it was just bullcrap. Why was I being searched? No, you weren't searched. You must have left your locker open last night. Friend 1 and friend 2 have their lockers next to mine, and they have basketball practice until 4. They shut my locker if I leave it open. I haven't been here since Friday. Are you telling me that everyone in this school left a locker standing open for all of Monday? I called my mom and was pulled out of school for Tuesday as well. Ultimately, all the charges were thrown out because of that marijuana plant. The chief of police put in his official report that it had been 8 feet tall. And when questioned about it, when they tried to press drug charges on mom, he clearly said, "Yes, Your Honor, it was 8 feet tall." The judge asked him when he found it, and he said about 1 in the morning. The judge then said if there really had been a marijuana plant that was 8 feet tall behind a 6-foot tall fence, he would not have needed to demand permission to search the property. The charges were thrown out. And that's where it stood for 10 years. Mom waited and played the long game because she wanted to make fully sure the statute of limitations ran out. She didn't want to give him any legal reason to retaliate against her. She waited and waited. Then, on the first town council meeting after the statute ran out, she made contact with one of the council members. In a small town, you don't screw with the council members. Everyone knows them, and everyone listens to them, or they do here at least. This was the head of the council too, and at the time, his grandson was my coworker, so he knew of me, and he liked me well enough since I worked for the largest business in our area. He listened to mom's story and told her that the last he'd heard, there was nothing in the evidence locker at the station at the moment, meaning none of the guns they had confiscated had been entered. When she told him most of them belonged to me and were basically family heirlooms, they were, he nodded and asked her that if he could produce those guns, could she prove they belonged to us? Mom said she had a notebook of descriptions of the guns, their serial numbers on the hunting rifles that had scopes, and that 2 of them had distinguishing marks that were hidden from sight, but she could find them and show them off. Because my mom loves having a paper trail on everything. He told her she would get them back that Monday. We found out that he went to the station and told the same police chief that because they had never successfully charged us with any crime, and that now the statute of limitations had run out, all of the confiscated property had to be turned back over to us. But there was a rumor that the guns weren't in evidence. He would be in on Monday to have it checked. The police chief went pale, and on Monday, they were all in the evidence locker. However, one of them was missing a scope. It came out somehow that the chief of police had never intended to enter them into evidence and had sold them to his friends. He'd been thinking he'd got away with it for a decade, until mom turned back up with proof that they belonged to her and legally had to now be returned. He had to go and buy back every one of them, sometimes paying more than twice what he'd been paid because some of these friends had not been speaking to him for some time, and one of them had taken the scope off a while back. He was immediately fired and arrested for it. We got our guns back. I'm glad OP got their property back, but I definitely feel like they didn't do enough. They went through 10 years of torture, but we don't even hear what happened to the neighbor. Did they just have satellite TV and everything was okay? I'm amazed that OP didn't enact any revenge on the neighbor. Or hopefully, that's coming in another installment at another time. I want to thank OP for posting their story to the ProRevenge subreddit. You can visit them at the links in the description below. Please go there and give them an upvote. Once again, this is Rob from Karma Comment Chameleon saying thanks for watching. If you enjoyed the video, please hit that subscribe button, drop a like, and share it with your friends. And we'll see you in the next one.